Impossible is a word people use to describe something they can't do. Sometimes they might want to be sadistic, sprinkle it with a dash of realistic, and say it's near enough impossible, nigh impossible. They'd like you to think you're lying in hospital for defying obstacles and trying not to fall, but their impossible isn't my impossible. There are no winners until someone's won it. You won't know what I'm capable of until I've done it. I could either stand here patient and listen, wanting to make an incision, having to wait for permission, or I could make a decision and I could take a position. Impossible is the manifestation of your inhibition. So fear of trying is fear of flying. Your mind's racing and your heart isn't out to help. They're turning against you and you're starting to doubt yourself. The nights were cold and the mornings were rough. Now you're worried about people calling your bluff, second guessing your ability and all of your stuff. But no, you alone is more than enough. This is the truth I saw before I went to sleep. I knew my time would come eventually. So I celebrate every test ever sent to me, because what's about to be was meant to be. It's remarkable to try, but I can't afford to die, knowing my ambition didn't kill me. Forget the voice of reason. Listen to the real me. No guts, no glory. Thank you. Obviously, I'm a poet, so I can go with that. I think that poem's called Impossible. I wrote that a while ago. I think it really sets the tone for what I want to speak about briefly today. Just to give you a bit of background on myself, I'm 21, I'm from Northwest London. My area of London is rather inner city, so it's prone to certain problems that you might have heard about in the Daily Mail, so accurately documented. But my environment has taught me a lot, basically, and that sets the tone for for basically my own perspective. And the first story that I'm going to share with you, I'm going to share a story of two men. First story I'm going to share with you reflects my environment pretty much. My friend's big brother, the older brother of a friend of mine, I grew up with him. I didn't know him for the first 10 years of my life. I'd always heard about him, I knew all the stories, I knew how funny and charismatic he was, but I didn't know him. That's simply because he was in prison. The first 10 years of my life, my friend's big brother was incarcerated. And he wasn't that much older than us. The reason he was in prison, bit of a long story, but to cut a long story short, he was 14 years old when he started cutting hair at the local barbershop. And a barbershop is very much a social hub. It's where everyone goes to just express the culture that we create, even though it's like, you know, we're making it up as we go along. But at the barbershop, there's a lot of weed smoking, or around the barbershop, I should say. This was the early 90s, when my friend's big brother had started cutting hair. And crack cocaine was really manifesting in earnest. You know, people were really experimenting with this new drug. And I think the social attitudes around crack was a bit different then. As I understand it, I wasn't there, but people used to smoke cocktail spliffs, what they call cocktail spliffs. So they'd sprinkle a bit of crack cocaine with weed. Now, for those of you who don't know much about weed, as I'm sure none of you do, the official categorization of it, classification, is a class C drug, isn't it? Crack cocaine is class A. These are very different kinds of drugs. Now, my friend's big brother, this 15-year-old at the time, was around the barbers, you know, he was getting into the swing of things, being induced into the way of life. One of the barbers, much older man, sprinkled crack cocaine in his weed, his spliff. He didn't know about this, he didn't know. But shortly, he developed a serious problem, a real addiction, as a young man, you know, 16, 17. And the barber, who got him addicted, being the lovely man he is, used this addiction to get him to do crimes for him. So he would send him to different countries to pick up drugs, come back, and it sounds really like, wow, like film like this. You know, it's actually real, it's exactly how you might have seen it in a movie. Send him to different countries to pick up drugs for him, and he got caught. So he's an 18-year-old, he takes the rap, he can't snitch, you know. He goes down for 14 years. That's the story behind him, the reason I didn't see him. Now, my mom always used him as an example of how the system could get a black man. How, you know, you're wandering along unsuspectingly, one minute you're just hanging out with friends, doing whatever your friends are doing because they've created this social context around it that makes it all right. Next minute you know, you're so far down the wrong path that there is no retribution for you. That always got me thinking. That always got me thinking about anyone that I would come across in any walk of life who was, you know, of a similar situation. So that leads me on to the next man that I want to talk about. This guy, he had a troubled childhood. His problem started much earlier than those of my friend's problem. So when he was 6 years old, his father was murdered. His father was murdered. A couple years later, when he was 14, his mum went to she was committed to a mental asylum. She had a nervous breakdown, and you know, like, he was separated from her, separated from all his brothers and sisters, had about four of them. What that led to was a situation where he was in a foster home, no one really cared about him, he was just, you know, maintaining. He had a much more difficult life than my friend's brother. Now, when he was 21, he was arrested for robbery. And he got sentenced to 10 years in prison. 10 years. So, you know, you can see the parallels. Whatever, young man gone off the rails, 10 years in his early 20s, spending this time in prison. Now, when he left prison, he went on to lead one of the greatest civil rights movements that the world has ever seen. When Malcolm X was 39, he was shot dead. My friend's brother is now 39, he's living with his mum. Drastically different realities. And I always think about the parallels. Both were drug dealers, both got locked up in their early 20s. Now, being locked up, as you can probably imagine, is scary. It's scary for a number of reasons, but mainly because it affects how you perceive your future. I understand. I haven't been locked up, but I've spoken to a lot of people. It affects how you perceive your future. You don't know how you're going to make it to the end of the day, let alone next week, let alone when you're eventually released. How are you going to sustain a living? How are you going to integrate back into mainstream society? Why would someone find this so daunting? It's a simple fact that we're scared of the unknown. It rattles our cage, it really upsets us when we don't know what's coming. That fear combined with no independence, no autonomy, the state telling you when you go to sleep, the state telling you when you're going to eat, that really breeds a sense of hopelessness. When people don't have options and they can't foresee a situation where they can take control, they have nothing to lose. And obviously, we can imagine what a society full of that attitude would be like, descending to what sociologists describe as anarchy. So much of what we do is dedicated to fighting the hopelessness. We want control, we fight for control. We work to make money so that we can buy what we need and what we want. Options are important to us. When we're in control, we can obtain what we want. That's a mechanism by which we can achieve that end. That's why we adhere to things like science and religion. They give us definite answers, hardcore answers that we can then navigate through life by. We can base our decisions on external sources of reasons that of reason that allow us to trust where we're going. But there's a problem. You never know what you never know. In order to wholeheartedly trust any kind of paradigm, be it religion, be it education, science, politics, in order to wholeheartedly give yourself to that, you need to be firm in the knowledge that they've got it under control. They know what they're doing. You need to wholeheartedly buy into that. Now, the danger of that is that they don't. They don't know what they're doing. There's always the danger that you're committing to something that is not that's not worthy of your commitment. Have you has anyone here ever missed a bus by seconds?
Yes.
I guess I'm not the only one. I'm a poet, but can anyone help me, because I'm struggling to articulate the rage that I feel. If there's anyone in the audience that can help me out with that one, that'd be good. But you know the feeling, you run, you chase the bus down, the guy definitely saw you. But anyway, that's frustrating as it is, but it's perhaps less serious when where you wanted to go isn't that far anyway. You know, you have the option of walking it. It's not raining, it's not a particularly bad day, so you can always walk. What do you do? Do you walk because you've just missed a bus, so you can comfortably confirm that another bus might not come for a while? Or do you wait? In that situation, for whatever reason, I'm impatient. I walk. I would rather stick to my decision to walk than wait around and leave my fate in the hands of a bus driver who doesn't care, because bus drivers don't have souls. And that's the conundrum. Do you take control, or do you leave it? Do you leave it to the unknown? We often find that the little things that we do, these little decisions that we make on a day-to-day basis, are based on the fear of what we can't predict, what we can't control. But the truth is out there. Whether or not I'm aware, there might be a bus down the road, there might be a bus 2 hours away, there is definitely an answer in that situation. The question is, how can we know? If we take the analogy of a sculpture, we can project that onto this kind of conception of knowledge. I'm not going to be the first one to say this. I can't remember where I first heard this, but if you think about a sculpture, what is it? It's a block of clay or whatever it is, whatever material it's made of. It was made to look like something. But what it started off as was just a clump of material. So what was the job of the sculptor in that sense? The sculptor then has to take away all the excess material to reveal what is already there. Discover the art within. Much the same as music. If you think of any musician, what do they actually do? Do musicians create music? In the same way that artists don't create the art, they merely remove everything, arrange what they're given in a way that makes it pleasant to the ear. Musicians don't create notes, they just organize them. This is the kind of conception of knowledge that I'm going with. Like art, facts exist regardless of whether or not we're aware of it. The world was round even when people thought it was flat. It's this process of discovery that transforms fact to knowledge. This suggests that, firstly, we probably don't know everything. Secondly, there's probably more to discover that we can actually learn. There are facts out there waiting to be found out. The fact that there is unknown knowledge means that no one can predict the future safely. So no matter what your situation is right now, you don't know what's in store. This is probably best illustrated in what's described as Goodwin's paradox. Anyone heard of Goodwin's paradox? Goodwin was a philosopher who came up with this idea of group. If you think about the color green, how do you know that it's green? You can see that it's green, and the title that has been given to the color that you perceive is green. But for all any of us knows, Whenever we look away, it turns into blue. How can you confirm that? You take a picture, but you have to look at the picture. You can't catch it off guard, because the nature of the substance is that it changes form when you're perceiving it. So how do you know what you're looking at? Alternatively, green could be a color called what Goodman described as grue. Given enough time, say by 2020, everything that's green will turn into blue. How do you know that that's not the case? You don't. All knowledge that we own is provisional. All our frames of reference are sufficient for the time being. That might sound facetious, but just stick with me on this one, because you can see where I'm going with it. You never know what is in store. All you can do is use your options to try and control the course of your life, whatever you're dealing with. In that exact same sense, you can't objectively project the trajectory of your life based on the evidence that you're given right now. Even when the teacher stood me up in front of my class and told me that my university choices were all unrealistic, that I needed to be more sensible about what I was doing, even then, it was still a fact that I would go on to get 5 unconditionals from the top unis in this country, and I'll go on to study at Cambridge University. Even then, it was still a fact. Even when I was 15 and I was in problem set for all of my subjects, and everyone used to laugh when I was struggling to finish homework, because I was just a bit of a crap student, really. Even then, it was still a fact that those same people that were laughing at me would be asking me for advice on Oxbridge applications, trying to understand why they were rejected, and I wasn't. At that point, this was still a fact. I just couldn't know that. Even when my friends laughed in my face at the thought of me writing lyrics, it was a fact that I was going to be the most successful lyricist of all of us. Rubbing shoulders with what used to be our favorite rappers. That was a truth that I had to find myself, because no one could envision it or make it happen for me. Malcolm X and Joe, my friend's brother, were both locked up in their 20s. But Malcolm was a great leader. Just like the sculpture, music, or any work of art, this was a fact that was destined to manifest itself into knowledge, i.e. a truth that is known. What does this mean about all the truths that we don't know? How can we ever write off anything comfortably? How can we ever be comfortable in the knowledge that what we've perceived thus far is all that we will know? What does this mean for Joe, my friend's brother? Does this mean that he'll never amount to anything? Not at all. His story is unfinished, just like Malcolm's was in prison. Potential is eternal. It doesn't just die, it gets wasted. You never know what you never know, because you can't begin to imagine the things you can't begin to imagine. It's for that reason that I implore you, believe in yourself. Believe in yourself, because no one can do that for you. You are the artist, and your future is the art. You need to seek it out actively. Thank you very much for the time.